This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic. This video is an introduction to solving nonlinear polynomial inequalities. Later, we will also do rational inequalities. And in this video, we solve this particular inequality. Below are examples of polynomial inequalities. And these are all nonlinear because they have x to some power more than 1, but they're all positive powers. So I have an x squared term or an x cubed term. In this last one, 2x plus 7 times x plus 7, that would be 2x squared. And they also, instead of having just equals, they either have a less than or a greater than or a greater than or equal or a less than or equal symbol. So first of all, that's what a polynomial inequality looks like. These are some examples. Before learning how to solve a polynomial inequality, let's just quickly review the steps for solving a polynomial equation using the zero product property. So remember what we do. We write the equation with zero on one side. We factor the other side. We set each factor equal to zero and solve the equation. And then we check each solution in the original equation. So here's an example showing all those steps. If you were to solve x squared equals 5x plus 6, my first step was set the equation equal to 0 by subtracting 5x minus 6 from both sides. Then I factor the left-hand side. I set each factor on the left-hand side equal to 0 and solve. And then I check each of those solutions in the original equation. So I plugged in 6 into the original equation, and I make sure I get the same number on both sides. And then I plug in negative 1, same thing. And since they both check, the solution set is 6 and negative 1. So in this polynomial equation of degree 2, because it's got x squared as your highest exponent is the 2, we end up getting at most 2 solutions. All right, let's change this up. Instead of x squared equals 5x plus 6, what if we are asked to solve x squared is less than or equal to 5x plus 6? First of all, this means the same thing as x equals 5x plus 6 or x squared is less than 5x plus 6. So it's going to have at least the two solutions we got in the previous example I just did. But our steps end up being very similar. So we start off by setting the inequality equal to 0. So we start off the same way, x squared minus 5x minus 6 less than or equal to 0. So step 1, again, we're going to put 0 on one side. Step 2, we're going to factor. So those steps are exactly the same as solving an equation, except I do have the less than or equal. But this is where it changes. You can't just say x minus 6 is less than or equal to 0 or x plus 1. That's not going to work. What we have here is a product that must be less than 0 or equal to 0. So whatever numbers I plug in for x, whatever's in the first parentheses will either be 0, positive, or negative, and whatever's in the second parentheses will be either 0, positive, or negative. And when I multiply those together, this is saying I need to either get 0 for my answer, or I need to get a negative number for my answer. So the product of x minus 6 and x plus 1 must be 0 or a negative number. All right, so the key point is to find what we call critical points. In other words, where each factor is exactly 0. So the critical points for this particular problem is we would take each parenthesis and set it equal to 0, right? It says where each factor equals 0. So x minus 6 Equals 0 means x would have to be 6. That's where this factor equals 0 exactly. And x plus 1. So that's similar to how we solved an equation, for instance. Now, if we plugged in 6 for x into this inequality, doesn't matter which one you do, but look at the second one. If you put in 6 for into this parentheses, x minus 6, you'd have 0 times something is less than or equal to 0. Well, 0 times anything is 0, so that would be a solution. So this would be a solution, and the same would be true of negative 1. But those aren't the only solutions here. There may be numbers in between there, or to the left of one of those numbers, or to the right of one of those numbers, etc. And so that's the key, is we need to find other ordered pair, other values for x. And for instance, let's say you picked a number like bigger than 6, like 100 for x. If you put in 100, this first parentheses would be 100 minus 6, and the second parentheses would be 100 plus 1. And notice that would give you some huge positive number. It's not that huge, it's 94, times some other positive number. And it doesn't really matter what those numbers are, but we know when we multiply, we're going to get a positive number, so it will not be less than or equal to 0. So 100 is not going to be a solution. So we're going to use this idea to find the rest of the solutions. All right, so again, here we start out with the inequality. Here we factor it. So our first step is to set each factor equal to 0. We get x equals 6. And x equals negative 1. And then since it's okay to also equal 0 when we plug in those numbers, that means these are two of the solutions. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to draw a number line over here. And I'm going to put those two critical points on the number line. So you could fill in a whole number line with all the little values, or I'm just going to write negative 1 is somewhere over here, 6 is to the right somewhere. That's what's really important. Now, since I have less than or equal, these are our solutions. So what I want to do is write that is a solution by putting a dot on it. If it was less than 0, not less than or equal, I would put a circle on it. We'll do a problem like that later on another video. All right, now, this breaks up this number line into three different regions. The part before negative 1, the part between negative 1 and 6, and the part to the right of 6. So what we're going to do is test a number in each of those regions. To the number left of negative 1, you could choose any number you want, and you're going to plug it in to whatever is in the parentheses here. All right? So we've got, I guess that's not going to give me enough room here. So I need to put in x minus 6. Pick a number less than negative 1. How about you put in, you know, negative 10? Doesn't really matter. All right, so if you're going to put in negative 10 for x, that will give you negative 10 minus 6. And then you're going to put in negative 10 for x in the other parentheses, same thing, right? Negative 10 plus 1. A lot of people do this in their head. And it really doesn't matter what those numbers are, but in the first parentheses, you note that's a negative number. Negative 10 minus 6 is a negative number. And negative 10 plus 1 is another negative number. Some people actually just put negative times negative, do that in their head. Now, what's a negative times a negative? That's a positive. So it tells you if you choose a value to the left of negative 1, I got a positive number. Okay, let's pick something in between negative 6 and 1. How about 0? And let's see if we could do this one in our head. So if we put in 0 into x minus 6, what does that give you? Putting in 0, well, you have 0 minus 6. That's just negative 6, or just a negative number. And you put in 0 over here, that's just 1, right? The main idea is you have a negative times a positive number. That's the important part. And a negative times a positive, that's a negative number. And then we'll choose the number to the right of 6. Again, let's see if we could do that in our head. Pick a number bigger than 6 in your head and plug it in for x minus 6. Like if you put 100 in, will this parentheses be positive or negative, this x minus 6? think of pinging a number bigger than 6 in, like 100. Well, 100 minus 6 is going to be positive, so you know the first parentheses will be positive. And then you're going to put in the same number bigger than 6 into the second parentheses. And that'll also be positive, right? Adding 1 to something? Positive. Okay, so I've got a positive times a positive. That is a positive number. Now, what are we looking for? We're looking for something where we're going to get a negative number. So keep in mind, you want to either get solutions that are 0 or a negative number. Okay? All right, so I already took care of the zeros. Negative 1 made this inequality 0, and 6 also made it 0. But where else would I get a negative? Where would I get a negative number? Right up here, it tells me. So the solution here is between, right here. So if you pick any number between these two, we end up getting a negative number. So our solution set on the number line could be written like that, or if you were going to use interval notation, of course you could, if you're used to writing your graph in interval notation, see my videos on that if you want to know, you could do it like this. And if you were going to write that using interval notation, it's in between negative 1 and 6 algebraically. So this is our answer right here. The solution to x squared minus 5x minus 6 is less than or equal to 0 is written in interval notation as negative 1, 6 with the brackets, because it includes negative 1 and 6. All right, I'm actually going to do the same problem very quickly, just talking about it. What if there was no equal sign here? What if it was just less than 0? Then I would not put a dot on negative 1 because I would not want to make this equation equal to 0, and you would end up putting a circle to show that's not part of the solution. And then we would have parentheses instead of brackets. So that's the kind of problem we're going to do on the next video. This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic.